This week, the Dow Jones Industrials and S&P 500 closed at yet new all-time record highs. Hello, everyone. Your host, Chris Waltzek here. Happy to be back with you this Memorial Day holiday weekend with another Muy Grande-sized show for you. First out of the bullpen, Bill Murphy from Gotta.org points to the gold cartel as the cause behind market volatility. But the opposition is running out of bullets, he says, in a vain attempt to suppress the gold price. Eventually, equilibrium will be reestablished, causing the market to launch higher. He highlights a recent article that shows how officials are racing to get ahead of the story that they were involved with the suppression scheme on gold and silver. Next at the plate, economist and best-selling author Harry S. Dent Jr. outlines his latest book, which reveals how demographic trends will overcome Fed stimulus, sending the Dow Industrials into a tailspin that could include a 50% decline or much more. Dollars and precious metals will be the investments du jour. His portfolio includes gold, and he expects as high as $1,450 on the yellow metal later this year. And Robert Ian wraps up the show with an encore report. GoldSeek.com radio begins now with a market weather report. Sunny skies appeared over the precious metals markets despite a solid dollar rally. Investors added to their precious metal stockpile in anticipation that robust economic conditions could cause renewed inflation issues. In addition, increased demand for gold from India due to relaxed import restrictions encouraged purchases. At Friday's closing bell on the New York COMEX exchange, gold finished near the break-even point at $1,293 an ounce, with still within earshot, though, of $1,300. The yellow metal is still higher for the year by about 5%. Silver picked up 11 cents, finishing at $1,947, close to break-even for the year. Palladium added $14, finishing at $1,830 on continued tensions between the West and Russia. Platinum finished at $1,476, up $10. Producers in South Africa expect their pay talks to continue with workers this weekend in an attempt to end that 18-week strike there. And West Texas Intermediate crude added $2 on increased tensions in Ukraine, ending just above $104 a barrel. The top story driving the precious metals this week. News from India. Demand for gold is expected to increase sharply after the Reserve Bank of that subcontinent loosed restrictions on imports. Inbound shipments may expand by 50% over the current figures, now that the balance of payment and current account are nearing equilibrium. A 10% import duty will likely be lifted soon, causing premiums to be halved, dropping from over $100 an ounce to about $50 in the next 2 weeks. In addition, gold demand is expected to rise, according to the World Gold Council, as high as 1,000 tons this year. Sales of new homes increased 6.4%, the best showing in nearly a year, a strong indication of robust economic output despite the cutback in toxic mortgage-backed security purchases by the Fed. The central bank reduced monthly asset buying to $45 billion in April, the fourth consecutive $10 billion cut. Nevertheless, the Fed's balance sheet is still approaching $5 trillion, growing by about a trillion per year. Meanwhile, a major bank was fined $44 million by Britain's market regulators for gold price manipulation 2 years ago. You'll want to stay tuned for my chat with Bill Murphy. He adds details to this story that I think every precious metals aficionado needs to hear. Bottom line on the precious metals. Well, you know, the dollar rally this week certainly put some pressure on the precious metals. I mean, the technical situation, though, is still in a consolidation. We've been bouncing around a very narrow range now for at least 2 months. There were some signs of distribution this week, but hopefully that will resolve itself soon. More details, forecast, and stock picks in the Alpha Stocks newsletter, so please log in. Or if you haven't signed up, we're still offering a discount, so you can do so this weekend. Visibility was virtually unlimited over Wall Street this week, with two of the major indices closing at all-time record highs on much better-than-expected home sales figures. For the week, the Dow was up 114 points, ending at 16,606. The S&P 500 picked up 22, ending right at 1,900, while the Nasdaq rebounded from key support at the 4,000 level, adding nearly 100 and finishing at 4,185. The equities markets did finish at all-time highs, due in no small part to continued improvement in corporate profits and the overall economy. Solid corporate earnings reports in the S&P 500. In fact, nearly three quarters have posted profits beyond the expectations of Wall Street analysts. Investors are turning to equities, which typically carry not only dividend yields, but the potential for significant capital gains beyond the typical bond fund. According to one top money manager, millions of investors are still on the sidelines, nervous after the credit crisis and therefore underinvested, leaving mounds of available funds for further upward market momentum. And we've been advising folks now for years here, especially at the Alpha Stocks newsletter, that this is a powerful bull market. I called a figure several months ago, actually over a year ago, in the Alpha Stocks newsletter and on this show, and we're approaching that figure now on the Dow Jones. So if you haven't logged in, you can at any time, and you can keep an eye on those trends and forecasts. Meanwhile, on the economic front, according to the Commerce Department, sales of newly built homes in the U.S. rose 433,000 in April, topping economists' expectations. Hewlett-Packard shares climbed sharply 6%, leading the S&P 500 rally. On news of solid quarterly earnings, plus IPO shale oil driller Parsley Energy leaped 20% on its first day of trading. The crude oil rally this week was also a big plus. Bottom line on Wall Street. Well, our seven-component sentiment index pendulum is still in the fearful level. This is great news for the bulls, because what it means is the typical investor out there is still shaking in their boots, too nervous to pull the trigger, and we've just had a breakout. So this is what you want to see. You want to see folks nervous because we've been consolidating for 2 or 3 months. They don't want to believe the breakout. In fact, our last breakout failed for a couple of weeks, and then now here we are again at all-time highs. So trying to time this, maybe not the best idea. You know, for the time being, the trend is your friend. Coming up after the break, more GoldSeek.com Radio with Harry S. Dent Jr. and Bill Murphy. We'd like for you to stay with us here at GoldSeek. Okay, it's great to be back with you for another GoldSeek.com Radio Gold Nugget segment. Today's special guest, Bill Murphy from Gotta.org and La Metropole Cafe. Well, Bill Murphy is at the helm of the Gold Antitrust Action Committee, Gotta, with Chris Powell working on behalf of precious metals investors to help expose market manipulation. Welcome back, Bill Murphy.
Good to be here, Chris. Thank you.
Gold prices settled higher today, regaining a lot of recent declines with strong signs of accumulation in the charts as traders are betting that reduced restrictions on gold imports in India could help boost demand. With them lowering some of these import rules, analysts are saying that this will essentially break the premium that we've noticed triple digits recently, and this could, of course, boost demand for the yellow metal. Any comments?
Yeah, well, I think that's in the market, and it's pretty much a given. India is a, you know, obviously a big gold-consuming country, and that to make it easier for the Indians to buy gold, the better. And it's in the market, but what really has got me going is this the most extraordinary action I've ever seen in a market in 40 years. It's a joke. I mean, it's all about the gold cartel, nothing else. I mean, it's gold, and then versus the physical market, gold gets down to 1280, silver gets around 19, they go up. They've shot up in minutes. Then the gold gets above 1,300. The gold cartel says no mas. They put up the signs. Goes dead the rest of the day. Goes right back down again. It's been going on 6 to 8 times now, in a not too long a period of time. And I've never seen this before. And I think you're right about the accumulation. It's leading something dramatic. I think sometime this summer, the gold market and silver markets are going to explode as the gold cartel blows up. I think they're going through the physical supply that they've been able to use to suppress the prices.
I wonder if you could tell us what signs you're seeing of the cartel losing their grip on the market. We've talked about this on the show a lot of times, and we know we are starting to see some signs of strength in the market every time things get weak.
Big one that surfaced the end of last week about the European Central Banks coming out 3 to 4 months ahead of time about their 5-year agreements to limit gold sales and so on. In that, they talked about gold stuff they were doing in the gold market without being specific, and they've never mentioned it before. And we think it's because they know that the S is going to hit the fan in the future, in the near future. And they're bureaucrats, and they want to get out and talk about that they were involved in the gold market all this time because we don't think that they have much gold left. And they've gone through it, and they want to cover their butts by being bureaucrats, letting people know, oh, well, we've discussed this in the past, and yes, we did mobilize gold and get it out there in the market. I mean, the big picture is we thought they were hitting the wall a couple years ago when gold was up towards 1900, but they were gearing up to mobilize gold for one major attack, and there's various ways they did it, the gold out of the Bank of England and disgorging ETS. People know this. And they were able to absolutely terrorize the gold market the past couple of years. And we think this reaction, at least I'll speak for myself, every time gold gets down around 1282, and this violent moves back up time and time again, it says they are finally running into trouble. And, of course, you've got an option expiry next Tuesday. And we think, we mentioned it way in advance, that they would be protecting the $1,300 price because they probably had a huge amount of calls written in the over-the-counter market. And it's playing out. It just seems there's a number of other things that seem to say that things are falling apart on them. You know, the silver fix is going to fold in the summer. And it's just one thing after another that says they're in trouble.
Sounds to me like what you're saying is some European officials want to get ahead. They're trying to get ahead of this story to cover their backsides because they were giving out information to certain parties who shouldn't have been privy to that knowledge well ahead of raids in the gold market. If this sounds fantastic, we just heard today traders are under investigation for having knowledge ahead of the FOMC meeting well in advance of our benchmark overnight lending rate, the decision on the FOMC rates. And they were trading on this for over a decade, about 15 years, and there's going to be quite an investigation there. You're right. I mean, it looks like they're starting to lift the veil behind the scenes here.
Chris, the exact quote is, the signatories will continue to coordinate their gold transactions so as to avoid market disturbances. In plain English, that's what God has been saying they've been doing for 15 years, is coordinating gold transactions to manipulate the gold price, in my terms. And this stuff is just prevalent everywhere. I would say it's funny because they used the word conspiracy nuts towards us, or they used to way back when. And that's the way most of these people do business, whether it was Enron, Madoff, what you're talking about, the LIBOR scandal. And that's what they do to marginalize people like us that stumble onto the truth. And I think finally the physical markets are seizing up on them. And, of course, it may not happen right away. It never seems to. It always takes longer than you think. But this stuff smells like a pressure cooker that this market's going to blow up, and they're trying to figure out what to do.
Speaking of blowing up, you know, we're seeing more tensions in the Ukraine, and this is kind of that story, I think, still making the back pages. But according to my sources, this could be quite a big story in the years going forward and something that could spark considerable geopolitical uncertainty in that region. And I wanted to get your take on what's going on there in the Ukraine and whether or not you see this as being an important factor for gold accumulation in the years moving forward.
Know what God knows, so do the Chinese. So I've explained that a number of times. They can pull the plug in the gold market anytime they want and create all kinds of havoc. Who knows what they're going to do there? But the Ukraine thing, yes, it obviously can be a big, big deal. Who knows what can play out? All I know is on a day-to-day basis and short term, the worse it gets in the Ukraine, the more the gold cartel steps on the price. Today, there was an announcement about all kind of murders over there or something. The gold dropped $10 on the news. I've never seen gold hold a gain on an international crisis in 15 years. Not one time. Never. Because they know that they don't want people looking at gold when they have an international crisis. The price goes up, and they make sure they take it right back down again. I mean, it may go up eventually again, but they never want it to be associated with a crisis.
And this, I think, is emblematic of what we're seeing there. I think we should also remember that, you know, Russia, huge, actually the world's largest exporter of oil. Many folks think of Saudi Arabia, but it's actually Russia that's just slightly ahead in their oil exports. And I'd also add that there was a big Russo-China oil deal made this week that I think knocks another pillar out from under the U.S. petrodollar hegemony. Are there any other stories that you're watching today? Any other news you'd like to share with the listeners?
Yeah, I want to emphasize this price action, how extraordinary it is, and that, you know, that it's, I've never seen it do this before over a short period of time. When you put it together with all these things you're talking about from a fundamental reason, I mean, it's all one-sided for gold and silver to go bonkers. I mean, if gold, I mean, simplistically, it kept pace with inflation, it would be double the price it is today. They, and I mean, this gold cartel has gold and silver at artificially low prices that cannot be sustained. And if they've gone, the main key to the whole market is what they're able to do with their physical supply of gold from central banks and how they mobilize silver. If they're hitting the wall on that, and you've had negative GOFO rates, and you've had all kinds of signs that they are having trouble, gold and silver are going to explode out of nowhere, and the moves up will be volatile and violent.
With negative sentiment now reaching levels we haven't seen in years, I mean, you can suppress markets easily because people have just simply tossed up their hands. They've given up hope. These markets can remain subdued even when, as you say, they should be flying much higher.
Absolutely. And, it's, and of course, the dichotomy, it's lasted for some time now between the shares and the precious metal shares and what's going on with the NASDAQ and the Dow and other stock markets. It puts even more pressure on our sector because money managers have to get rid of investments in our sector because they have to maintain performance, and people are getting disgusted and saying, why am I doing this? And it's been very effective. And you're correct. The sentiment is as bad as I've ever seen it. Of course, that sets up something out of the blue, which is going to have it go bonkers. But for the time being, we're still in the weeds.
No, exactly. And as you say, just as markets gain momentum on the upside due to the derivatives and options and all the leverage out there that can be deployed by very large institutions with deep pockets, so we can see the same on the downside. So I think we will see, as Jim Sinclair has pointed to and alluded to for over a decade now, that as this gold market matures and we might be entering that third big stage here, we will see 100-point, 200-point or more moves on the upside eventually, don't you think?
Smart as they come, and he's going to be right. Predicting anything in the very short term is nearly impossible because these guys, this gold cartel, as we call them, they come out with and that's another sign, by the way. They've been coming out every other day with a flash crash attack where they might take down gold down anywhere from $5, $6, $7 to $15 and do it in minutes with many tons of gold hitting the market at once. They're seeming to have to resort to this tactic over and over again, and it hits the lower price level, and boom, we spike right back up again. So it's an extraordinary war, what I call the gold war, between this gold cartel and the physical market, which is beginning to seize up on them.
I wonder if you could tell folks more about the interesting services that you provide at La Metropole Cafe.
Well, people can sign up at gotta.org. It's a free list that Chris Powell, my colleague, does a great job with, and I have a website since 1998, La Metropole Cafe, and listeners can sign up for a two-week free trial and see if it's of value.
Well, Bill Murphy, we appreciate your thoughts, as always, staying on top of these markets for us.
Thank you, Chris. Good day.
Okay, you're back with us at GoldSeek.com Radio for another Gold Nugget segment. Today's special guest, Harry S. Dent Jr. Well, my next guest says that the Great Recession may soon be followed by the Great Deflation. Joining me today, Harvard-educated economist Harry S. Dent Jr., head of an economic research and forecasting company and author of his latest best-selling book, The Demographic Cliff, How to Survive and Prosper During the Great Deflation of 2014 through 2019. Welcome back, Harry S. Dent Jr.
Oh, nice to be back, Chris.
Let's begin with the demographic cliff. You say that the accelerating trend here of the baby boomer retirement could just put the economic engines into stall mode. You know, you correctly predicted the baby boom economic miracle that we saw in the 1990s, but your work is showing that, once again, that this might be coming to a halt. Could you give us more information, please?
Yeah, you know, it's even before retirement. The average household peaks in spending at age 46 when their kids are getting out of school, you know, high school or college. And it's later for more affluent people, a little earlier for the average person. But this is something we can predict decades in advance, when the baby boom will spend in a country and when they will start to slow down on their spending. And then many years after that, they retire, and that's even worse because then they continue to spend less, but they don't earn money, and they draw benefits from all types of sources. So this is the most important thing driving our economy. And the point of this book is that this has been happening in different countries and different regions around the world. Japan was the first to peak way ahead of the United States and Europe, kind of a double peak in late 89 and then late 96, and then their demographic trends turned sharply down. Well, Japan's been in a coma economy ever since, requiring endless quantitative easing. Well, the next country to peak, and big country, was the U.S., and we predicted that 20 years ago, that the baby boom here on a 46-year lag on the birth index would peak around late 2007, and of course, we've been, you know, having to endlessly stimulate to have the weakest recovery in history ever since. So we're kind of in a coma economy, just not quite as bad as Japan, because our echo boom, the generation to follow, is a little larger here. But the big point is that I'm looking at countries like Germany and Italy and in many countries in Europe, but especially Germany, who's supposed to hold Europe together. Germany's demographic chart for spending ahead looks worse than Japan's in the 90s. And I was the only person I know of that called the fall of Japan back in 1989 and said at the same time Europe and the United States would have the greatest boom in history in the 90s. Because, again, it's just simple demographics. So we're saying people keep thinking, oh, we're turning the corner on this recovery and housing has bottomed and stocks are at new highs and, you know, everything's okay. Everything is not okay. All we've done is engineer an artificial bubble without the fundamental trends of baby boom spending and technology progress behind it. And we think this bubble's getting ready to burst because it's just gone about as long as you can bring it with just simply quantitative easing and artificial stimulus. So the stock market's seen new highs every time we've had a bubble, a peak in 2000 and then 2007 and now 2014 here. And every crash after those new highs has taken us to new lows. It's called a megaphone pattern. So that's the most likely scenario I see, is that we're going to peak a little higher here. I don't think this rally's quite over, but somewhere around 17,000 on the Dow, and then the next stop is a new low, 6,000, a little lower, and then most people just aren't prepared for that.
Take a look at the Fed's balance sheet. I mean, they may be tapering on the one hand, but on the other side of the equation, we're approaching $5 trillion. Think of it, if it was on a corporate balance sheet, investors would be just dumping shares and selling short the company.
I mean, people in marketing and sociology study demographics. In fact, demographics is the holy grail for marketing people. I came out of a business consulting background in Harvard Business School and business strategy. I studied marketing and consumers and product life cycles and demographics and all this sort of stuff. Economists don't study this. And the only area that they do pay attention to demographics is they do understand that in most, you know, developed wealthy countries, Western countries, including East Asia, Japan, and all those, that there's going to be more and more older people and fewer young people to support them. That's the only place they see it. I'm like, okay, that's the back end of the train. What I understand, and this comes right out of government statistics that are readily available to anybody, from cradle to grave, we know when people do everything, when they buy camping equipment, eat the most potato chips, gain the most weight, eat the most calories, buy the most cars, houses. I mean, you name it. I mean, I've got hundreds of categories I can quote and tell you exactly when people peak and slow down, so that we can see when different sectors of our economy will boom, and we can see overall when people peak in spending. This is the simplest thing in history. It's easy to project in the future, and you're right. Economists have just absolutely ignored it. I have people get on, I'm on CNBC and stuff like that, and people just say, hey, consumers don't matter. Demographics don't matter. It's all about, you know, government policy and this and that and that. And I'm like, do you think any government policy is more important than the predictable spending patterns of 317 million people in the United States? And we can tell you exactly when they're going to spend. I mean, it just, people don't want to change whatever they studied. You know, this is important. Somebody like me comes up with something new. It's kind of like I always tell people, like, you go in history, one of the bigger examples, you know, scientists like Galileo comes up and says, hey, guess what, folks? You know, the universe doesn't revolve around us. We revolve around the sun. Oh, man, all they had to say to him was, which stake do you want to be burnt at?
Well, you know, the other thing he would have said in reply was, I just created a refracting telescope. Let's take a look at Jupiter and the moons that revolve around this nearly stellar planet. You know, you talk about people's lack of understanding. I listened to a physicist the other day who was vindicated after decades of being left just derelict by the side of the road by his community, and they've recently embraced his string theory as absolute proof. They asked him, well, how does it feel to be vindicated? And he said, you know, at first it hurt to be ignored, but I knew it was right, and it was just a matter of time.
Yeah, I always tell people, you know, I'll probably be dead. But I mean, I came up this in the late 80s. Like I say, I've been saying this stuff for 25, 30 years, proving it, documenting it. Predicted stuff nobody predicted. Again, nobody predicted the simultaneous collapse of Japan and the greatest decade in history for other countries like the U.S. and Europe. I mean, and people just, you know, they'll find out one thing you mispredict and say, well, see, this guy doesn't know what he's doing. I mean, it's just the way it is. And I'm just like this guy. Like, look, I know this is right. And I just, all I do is talk to the people willing to listen. I can't convince people.
And, you know, you talk about mass retirement of the baby boomers, but this won't be enough to contain inflation. You know, it's the massive debt deleveraging that could come back to bite us, and that this might lead to a frightening deflation that could weaken the economy for the next 5 years. Laser point in here on 2014 through 2019, please.
Well, you know, every other generation, you know, you get a generation like the baby boomers, and they bring radical new innovations like microcomputers and the internet mainstream as they grow up. You know, they innovate them when they're young, and then they adopt them, and you get a bubble boom. The last bubble boom we had was from 1914 to 1928, 29, you know, the roaring 20s. And then, those bubbles bring a lot of new business models and a lot of innovations that pay off decades later. But, you know, there is a lot of debt. There is overinvesting. Financial assets get overvalued. So you get a debt and a financial asset bubble. Those bubbles have to burst at some point. And a lot of companies have to fail, because the truth is most innovators, and I am an entrepreneur more than I am an economist, and I've consulted to a lot of entrepreneurial companies, and I'll tell you what they do. They fail 9 out of 10 times. They just fail. They're like, there's kind of a washout, and then that's what I call the winter season. It's deflation instead of inflation, like we saw the summer season in the 70s. And so it's debt deleveraging, it's financial bubbles bursting, costs being driven down as businesses. It's very good for the economy. It's very good for prices to go down. Deflation's a very powerful force in innovation long term and bringing more and more products mainstream, but it's the most painful season. In the 1930s was that last deflation season, winter. And what we've seen since 2008, we started going into that season as we predicted 20-some years ago. But this time, government studied, you know, and central bankers like Bernanke and all this studied the Great Depression. They said, well, we just won't allow deflation. We'll just turn up the temperature. And that's what quantitative easing is. They're inflating to fight deflation. They're keeping banks alive with plenty of reserves and injections of cash so they don't go under and they don't write down loans. The truth is, if we wrote down all these bad loans against overinflated real estate and business value, we would take a huge burden off the private sectors, business and consumer. I mean, I think of, instead of saving the banks, let the banks get under pressure and then force them to write down mortgage loans for everyday consumers and households who bought a house at 10 times their income, which they should have never been allowed to do, but the banks and the government and everybody pushed it. So that's the thing. Governments are preventing this reset. You know, this reset will bring down education costs, the health care spiral. It'll force us. The baby boomers aren't going to retire at 62 to 65. That's going to be the result, because we can't afford to in our life expectancies have gone up 10 years in the last couple of decades, and we haven't adjusted for this. So we should be retiring at 72 to 75 instead of 62 to 65. We need to reset a lot of things here. And instead of dealing with reality and restructuring this debt, governments are just keeping the bubble going. And they've kept this bubble going another 5 years. It crashed in 2009. We were going into a depression-like economy. It was very obvious. They called it, you know, the next Great Depression. So I'm looking for us to hit the pavement starting this year. And the best cycles I have now all point down at the same time from 2014 to 19. The only time that's happened in the last, in the history, you know, last century and a half has been 1930 to 34, and that was the Great Depression. So that's what I'm looking for, debt deflation and deleveraging. And we're inflating now, but ultimately when this debt deleverages and tens of trillions of dollars of debt disappears, that's money disappearing. When the stock markets fall 80%, which is typical in these things, and financial assets, that's money disappearing. Less money chasing the same goods is the classic definition of deflation.
Well, your thesis certainly sounds like a page torn out of Joseph Schumpeter's Creative Destruction. It certainly seems to have some merit there. I mean, at least the axioms hold up, I think, if we look back throughout history. But, you know, I still think that our officials, you know, you've heard the expression, don't ever try to convince someone the opposite if their job, their income, depends on it.
Or the establishment. But it's easy to understand what president or prime minister or central banker would want to have the next Great Depression, debt deleveraging. I mean, that 1930 to 33 was the single worst time in all of U.S. history. The highest unemployment, the greatest stock crashes, the greatest numbers of bankruptcies, and you know, and then they had a dust bowl and drought on top of that. It was a horrible time. Everybody would rather push the can, you know, kick the can down the road and let the next administration deal with it. That's what everybody's doing. And people are going to do it until something goes wrong, the next trigger goes off, the next subprime crisis, and that is going to be in China. Is the most likely trigger I see, but also Germany going off the steepest cliff of any country in the world, even steeper than Japan in the 90s, is right ahead in the next 8 years. And the U.S. real estate recovery is faltering because it was never real in the first place. It was mostly speculators buying, not real families on mortgages. We've been saying that for years. Look at the people who apply for a mortgage to purchase a house, and it not only crashed, it flatlined ever since. It never recovered. Real people are not buying real homes. So this real estate recovery is now faltering, even though they keep the economy going at 2% or so with all this quantitative easing. But if real estate doesn't come back, we're in trouble.
Why don't we offer some solutions here? You know, many listening to our voices today will be nearing the retirement age. Retirement planning, very important. This is a common theme. Listeners know why we refer to it as the dismal science. In emails that healthcare, real estate, education, investing, business strategies, these are also topics that you have covered in your latest book. Could you tell us more, please?
Yeah. Chapter 7, we look like the scope of where you can invest narrows when bubbles are bursting everywhere. I mean, in 2008 and early 2009, everything went down. Commodities, real estate, stocks, international, emerging countries. I mean, only the highest quality bonds and cash-like investments did well. And the U.S. dollar actually rallied 27% while most currencies fell. So there's three places to go. One is you just get more liquid, getting cash, safe investments, let the bubble burst. In other words, you're going to harvest your gains after this third great bubble and let things crash so you can buy stuff at 10, 20, 30, 40 cents on the dollar again and have better long-term investment. The second thing you can do, the safe haven tends to be the U.S. dollar. So the euro has gone up. The U.S. dollar has gone sideways for a while now. We're telling people if stocks are about to peak, you know, buy a bullish dollar fund or UUP, which is an ETF that tracks the dollar index versus six currencies. And the third thing you can do if you want to take some more risk is you bet on stocks going down. And you know, I have to debate a lot of people like Peter Schiff and stuff who agree with me on this crisis. It's coming. There's no way governments can put this off forever. And printing money obviously is no solution long term. But he sees more inflation. I see more deflation. I said, well, look, there's one investment that will do well in either scenario, and that is being short stocks. Stocks don't like inflation like the 70s, and they don't like deflation like the 30s. It didn't like 2008 when we started to get some deflation. So that's three areas you can kind of say, okay, I'm going to be a certain percent kind of just safe T-bills, a certain percent long the U.S. dollar, and a certain percent short stocks, depending on my risk tolerance. And that's how you can actually make money in the great deflation. But the biggest opportunity is being able to buy real estate. Let's say you're getting near retirement, and you also, you know, you not only want to retire well, protect your assets, but you want to, you know, you want to buy a beach home somewhere. Well, just wait, you know, a few years. You're going to be able to buy stuff, vacation homes, at unbelievably low prices, and anything else, including a boat or a Ferrari. Boats are going to go for it. But, you know, boats are a what I call the black hole of the midlife crisis. You know, for males, that's the end game. Is it let this crash happen? At some point, government policies to keep the bubble going forever are going to fail, and then when that bubble crashes, the world's going to be on sale, and only the people who have cash and cash flow are going to be able to take advantage, because a bank's not going to lend you a nickel on anything.
You've gone on record in the 5,800 to 6,000 level on the Dow. If we saw a repeat of 2008, 2009, or some other credit crisis scenario, certainly we would expect to see a revisit to those levels. I wonder if you could give us more specifics. As we look back now over the last credit crisis, what we saw was systemic bad debt. We were leveraged to the hilt, our financial sector. We had mortgage-backed securities blowing up left and right all throughout the system, and it was just an absolute disaster of deleveraging. But didn't the Frank Dodd Act protect us from the next scenario? And it really did nothing of the sort. So really, there's been very little change throughout the system. Maybe we will have the, you know, the legs of the table knocked right out here. The Fed has nothing they can do. Or as you mentioned, Peter Schiff, where he says, well, they'll just print their way out of this one.
Well, at some point, printing doesn't work. I mean, who's going to allow the government to say, okay, we printed money for 5 years, unprecedented, and then the economy rolled over and failed anyway, and now we're just going to do twice as much? Well, maybe you can do that, but they're going to be too late. I mean, you saw how quickly things melted down in late 2008. So even if they do print money, they're going to be behind the game, because right now they're tapering, you know, and Europe hasn't been printing money since early 2012. Japan's the only country printing more money right now, so they're probably going to be too late on that. And then, yes, when I say Dow 5,800 to 6,000, that's the first stop. That's the next, and that's the biggest crash. I think you'll see a bounce after that for a year or two. There'll be some other, you know, recovery stimulus plan. But my trends and demographics and geopolitical cycles and commodity cycles and kind of a decennial boom-bust cycle, they all bottom more around, you know, 2019, 2020 or a little later. So I think that's when you'll see the Dow more at 3,000 to 4,000. It is very typical in these winter seasons and these debt deleveraging that major stock markets, and we've already seen this in Japan, they've already gone through this, you know, go down about 80%. And the Great Depression was actually 89%, but typical is 80%. I mean, that's going to take us more to the 3,000, 4,000 level, and that would actually erase the bubble that started back in late 94. So that 6,000 is not the ultimate low, and there will be a bounce. I think you're going to see two crises in the next 6 years, between 2014 and 19. One in the next few years, and then a final one that'll probably be less extreme. The most extreme will probably be the next one that hits. 5 years of unprecedented stimulus, things fail anyway, people are going to lose faith in governments and everything. I mean, this is going to be a pretty hard sell to come and down and say, well, yeah, what we did failed and just made things worse, but hey, now we're going to do it twice as much. Yeah, well, maybe they can sell that. I think it's going to be a hard sell.
But when you start to talk about $2,000, $3,000, $4,000 on the Dow, I mean, we're talking about watching the middle class and the recently affluent, the nouveau riche, completely wiped out, because very few of them are invested in commodities or anything of substance. It's all in paper. And leveraged securities, ETFs blowing up left and right. You're going to see an entire generations left destitute with no savings whatsoever, frankly, mortgaged to the hilt. So this can't bode well for the real estate market.
We've said from the beginning, bubbles go back to where they started or a little lower. And the real estate bubble around the world basically started in early 2000. Just for real estate to go back to where it was, just in January of 2000, it has to fall 55% from the top and 45% from this bounce. So we see an even bigger downturn in real estate coming. Of course, yeah, this is going to be horrible for real estate with unemployment and homes underwater and all that stuff in the first crash. It's going to be the affluent who've been spending more than ever, investing more than ever. They're the ones going to be hit this time. Basically, the Fed has bailed out the affluent. That's what they've done.
Give us an idea, though, of what we should expect for the middle-class individual listening to the show who's interested in purchasing a home. They've been waiting by the sidelines. And, you know, some of my guests here claim that the powers that be are going to continue pushing up these prices as the mortgage trusts and home buying and REIT trusts continue to accumulate, build up their balance sheet with a huge number of foreclosed homes and REOs, and then eventually they will dump that all on the market in the next few years as interest rates continue to ratchet up. If you were talking to your neighbor who was purchasing instead of renting, what advice would you give them?
I'd say rent, and I tell especially younger people, and I've got two stepkids, and I'm just telling them, I know you want to buy a home, I know you're in that age range, wait a few, just wait for the next year to see if things start to crack, as I'm saying, and if things do start to crack the next year, then you're probably going to have to wait 3 years or more, but you're going to get a much better deal on a home, and you're going to get an even lower mortgage rate. And then a lot of other people, I say, if you're like really underwater in your house, don't make a deal with the bank now. Let it get, I mean, it's going to get worse, and they're going to have to take more of the hit down the road. At some point, governments are going to have to give relief to households and quit favoring banks. And that'll only happen when they realize they can't save the banks. And the banks do. They're saying, oh, there's not enough homes on the market now. Banks are holding back massive levels of foreclosed inventory because they don't want to take the losses and they don't want to shoot themselves in the foot and depress the market. The governments are allowing them to do this. If they make them mark to market or banks no longer get all this endless cash flow from the Fed and can hold these things, they're going to have to dump them. At some point, they're going to have to start dumping these homes, and that's when you buy. That's when you get the great bargains.
I agree with you there, because certainly as rates continue to move higher, that makes mortgages far less affordable. Home prices have to come back into equilibrium with demand, and demand will continue to curtail because we're seeing folks just walk away from mortgages. They're simply unaffordable, and that theme, I think, will continue. Now, but there's still another scenario here that I know that folks are going to be asking themselves. They're going to say, look, but the Fed, you know, they're taking their foot off the stimulus, going to continue tapering. That program's probably gone this year. They're talking about raising rates as soon as next year. Why shouldn't we lock in a low-rate 30-year mortgage now if we're planning on staying in the house for the next 20 years?
Yeah, well, I think, you know, that would have been better in late 2012 when we were at 1.38% on the 10-year Treasury bond. But, yeah, we're still at low rates. My forecast is that rates are going to go up about a point or a little more. And then when the economy slows down and things fall apart and deleveraging sets in, you're going to get deflation instead of low inflation. And that's going to make bond yields potentially go even lower. So I think rates are going to go up maybe for the next year and then start tapering down. So you could either refinance now, and you can still get a good rate, you know, with the Treasury at 2.5% right now. But I think 2015, 16 or so, you probably get an even lower mortgage rate. But refinancing now is not a bad idea because rates have come back down, and I think they are going to go up in the next year at least a point and a half, something like that. And yeah, that's going to make you look good for refinancing now. Gold really got smashed last year, and I think it's going to tend to go contrary to the market at first, and that's what happened last time. Gold went up several months after the stock market started crashing in 2008, but then it followed in late 2008. So I think that's more the scenario. Right now, if I have gold, I would hold it and look for higher prices. I'm hoping to see 1400, 1430 or something like that in the next several months or so. And then if I got there, I'd say, yeah, I don't think this is a good environment for gold while we're going through this deleveraging. Because you're right, it's deflation. And my forecasts are that the U.S. dollar will rise into 2015 or 16, probably into at least late 2016. So dollar's up, that means gold and most commodities are down.
Well, generally speaking, but we've seen several instances where that correlation didn't exactly hold true. And, you know, there's another interesting, I think, piece to this puzzle. I mean, if we look at the development there in India with the National Democratic Alliance victory, I mean, this certainly could lead to a lift of most, if not all, of the gold import in their attempts to, you know, obviously buoy the rupee currency. Without that factor going forward, I mean, I think we could see a return to India on the forefront of consumption of the metal, competing directly against China, which is now the world's largest consumer of gold. I mean, the combination could be dynamic for gold moving forward. Any thoughts?
I see China taking the hardest landing. India is my favorite country for the future. They've underbuilt everything. China's overbuilt everything. India's got way more urbanization potential, way more demographic potential. So I think China's going to be a negative for gold, and India's going to be more positive. Gold is one of the hardest to predict, because I can look back at history and see what most things do, but in history, governments have always manipulated gold. You know, either outlawed it or usurped it or fixed the price or something like that. So gold's a little harder to get a read on. That's why I'd rather be short stocks than long gold to play a crisis. But gold is the hardest thing for me to predict out of all this. I just think, as you said earlier, you know, deflation based in a rising dollar in a crisis, gold is a crisis metal, you know, so that's a plus. But deflation will be a lot different environment than the inflation of the 70s.
Well, I'm sure you'd agree, though, that you'd much rather be in a hard asset like gold as opposed to paper assets in a deflation. I mean, sure, the depression wasn't exactly good for the yellow metal, but I mean, compared to the 90% loss,
stocks absolutely got crucified.
Yeah, and I think it's going to be worse this time because the prevalence of paper money it's systemic. I liken it to a forest fire. So it's going to all go up in a giant blaze, at least if what you've outlined so far comes to pass as planned. All right, as we wrap up here today, other than the U.S. dollar, what's the safe haven here? I mean, what should folks be looking at other than UUP to protect their wealth? I mean, should they just be in cash? Should they be stuffing greenbacks under their mattresses?
Yeah, I mean, really, cash-like investments, T-bills, you know, just cash in an account, bullish dollar and short things like stocks. Those are the three things. You know, you can't have the normal portfolio that says, oh, I'll have a little commodities, I'll have a little large cap stocks, a little small cap, a little real estate, a little commercial, a little international, a little emerging market. In 2008, 2009, all those things went down. So you have to decide. Number one is preserve your gains. I mean, we've just seen the greatest bubble in history, a series of them and everything. So everything's overpriced. So this is a time to lock in gains and say, look, I'm just going to preserve my cash so I know I got something real. And then if there's a crash, my gosh, you got cash, you can buy anything you want.
Would you say that you weren't caught blindsided by the 2007-2008 credit crisis? I mean, did you see that coming?
So we predicted it 20 years, and we predicted that starting in the late 80s. And just when we predicted the Japan collapse in the 90s, we said a similar thing's going to happen in the United States starting around 2008. You know, it's just, that's when the favorable demographic trends turn against you, and then if you're sitting there loaded with debt and problems, the creepy crawlers are going to come out, and that's just what happens. So, no, we're not surprised by it. It did build very fast out of nowhere. I mean, these derivatives and like you say, these mortgage-backed securities that were done to a level that people just weren't aware, and again, they never really dealt with that. We still have all these derivatives running around. We still have all these mortgage-backed securities and stuff. The Fed just bought enough of them to keep the banks from failing with them. So this has all been artificial to cover up this thing. They haven't dealt with the debt. This is a debt crisis. This is a financial bubble, and they haven't dealt. They've just created bigger bubbles, and now we have more total debt in the system than we had before the 2008 crisis.
Few people have really addressed one of the ways they got away with it. Maybe Michael Lewis, I think, did a great job talking about this in his latest book. And also Frank Portnoy in Fiasco, which is one of my favorite, because this alerted people 10 years ahead of the credit crisis what was coming. He was actually selling the toxic debt. The reason why they could get away with it is just like Enron, it was hidden in the balance sheet. It was hidden in the income statement. And this is how they did it. It's a subtle little nuance here. By dressing up this toxic debt, it doesn't show up in the interest coverage nor in the debt to equity.
Well, and also these firms, Chris, say, oh, but we're insured. You're insured by derivatives on leverage with traders with no collateral. This is not insurance. All the derivatives did was make everybody think all this leverage was safe. So people took bigger risk and bet on things. And so, the whole thing is going to look very, very bad from a historical point of view.
No, I think it's well said. And my point simply was the traditional Warren Buffett method of grabbing the latest report on the corporate report and reading through it, you couldn't thumb through the financial statements because they were irrelevant. That's what these toxic mortgage, not just mortgages, but the toxic debt in general and the collateralization of our country essentially did. I mean, but the Fed has swallowed all of that bait as well. It's not just a corporate situation, municipal situation. It's now federal and global in scale. I think your scenario, I think you'll be vindicated. This will be proven right to watch the authorities do just as they did in all the other crises going back as far as you can think of. I mean, it'll be interesting to see because they try every trick in the book to avoid what's inevitable. But there's one thing that folks can do. They can protect their hard-earned wealth by having some cash and having some precious metals.
Once we have the deflation and the deleveraging, no, that'd be a great time to buy real estate again. But real estate's not going to come roaring back either. I've got a new analysis in Chapter 3 of the book called, you know, Real Estate Will Never Be the Same, because we've never seen a larger generation be followed by a smaller one in most countries. There's going to be more people dying, and dyers are sellers by definition, more people dying and selling homes than young people. Dropping like a rock is where it fits in. It drops like a rock. We've been predicting this for 20 years. When we get this winter season and this downturn, immigration will drop. I mean, already 2009 and 10, there were more people going back to Mexico than coming here. Think all the people that built this huge real estate bubble in Spain. A lot of those immigrant workers, they're going back to North Africa.
There are entire cities, not just villages, but there's cities that look like ghost towns.
Well, China's even worse. Wait and watch what happens. It's the biggest bubble in the world, and when it goes down, everybody says they're going to have a soft landing. I say they're going to fall like an elephant.
Do you think that Singapore, which is more strategically located between all of the economic superpowers, then might rise out of the ashes? I mean, located between Australia, China, India, and the United States.
Maybe at first, but the Chinese and these foreign buyers are the very people who are buying. I mean, Singapore is the most expensive city in the world. They're the ones keeping up Sydney and Melbourne real estate. I was just there in February lecturing for 3 weeks, and everybody thinks, well, we can't go down because of this, that, and that. I mean, that's exactly why you're going to go down. You're being propped up by affluent Chinese who are fleeing their country. And when their bubble bursts, just like the Japanese in the late 80s, early 90s, then they're not going to be able to buy your properties anymore, and then they're going to sink because nobody in your country can afford your real estate.
It's always a pleasure hearing your thoughts, and we're going to look forward to having you back on the show.
Thanks, Chris.
Hey Chris, this is Robert Ian with ConquerChange.com. Everywhere you look, significant tensions are rising across the country and around the globe. As economies contract, the law of scarcity is asserting itself as people and groups fight for what are noticeably fewer and fewer deck chairs on a sinking economic ship. The Clive and Bundy story is being packaged and shaped by mainstream media to serve multiple political agendas. As time passes, it appears to have less to do with alleged illegal cattle grazing and is becoming a lightning rod for a host of hot-button issues from states' rights to federal authority to militias, to taxation, to numerous others. Realistically, it cannot serve all these issues, because a confused mind does nothing. And isn't that the point? When an issue initially has legs and has a significant chance of success, that is when it is the biggest threat to those who oppose it. The best way to kill an issue that is gaining traction and that people can easily understand, at least initially, is to water it down with so many other issues they may not be able to agree with that they intellectually let go of their association to that idea and decide to wait for something easier and clearer to understand. Such is the soup of the modern media, and how easy it is to misdirect and close people's minds to what is, or at least was, initially a simple idea. But that's the point. The ability for any real discourse to take place, for any extended period of time on any single subject, before being polluted with all kinds of extraneous information and agendas that are designed to peel away interest and credibility from the initial subject matter, is so limiting our attention spans before we get diverted to inaction that the status quo remains pretty much the same. And the march toward less freedom and more surveillance continues. If you watch how this relatively simple story has morphed into issues that were never on the table in the first place, you can see how desperate those in power are to shapeshift the information that is conveyed to the masses and refocus various political agendas into a divide-and-conquer mindset. Change will happen quietly, slowly, surely, and it will happen one person at a time. That's why the most important catalyst for change is not the president. It's not the media. The most important catalyst for change is you. And until next time, this is Robert Ian with ConquerChange.com, reminding you to follow us on Twitter @ConquerChange. Thanks, Chris.